Blog Talk Radio.
Hello and welcome to episode number 66 of Songs of Selah here on 17 Numa Radio. I'm your host, Scott Thomas Outler, and I want to thank everyone for tuning in this evening. It is Monday, August the 5th, 2019. Another new month is underway, and I hope that it's treating everyone well so far. Looking forward to tonight's episode. Coming up in the next segment, we'll be joined by tonight's guest, Marianne Szlyk. She'll be on to discuss her work, which includes her most recent book, On the Other Side of the Window, and she'll also be discussing the work that she does at her poetry and prose venue called The Song Is, where she's editor-in-chief. Phone lines will also be open on the program tonight at 646-668-8757. During the second hour, there will be an open mic segment for anyone who might be interested in calling in to read a few pieces of their work. And if you have questions for Marianne, please do call with those as well. Anyone that is interested in staying in the loop with future episodes of the program can do so by subscribing to the channel. It's free, it's quick, and it's easy. Just click on the follow button found above the slideshow here where the episode is streaming, and that will get you set up to receive notifications for all future episodes and the guests that are lined up in the months ahead. There's also an archive of all past episodes that can be accessed at any time. Wanted to thank last week's guest, Alexis Roan Fancher, for coming on and talking about her work. Had a great conversation with her, and also thank you to everyone who called in during the second hour last week. That archive of past episodes can also be found at my website, 17numa.com. If there's anyone interested in appearing as a guest on a future episode, you can get in contact with me via email at 17numa@gmail.com or connect with me on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter and send me a message on any of those platforms. Be more than happy to get you set up for an episode later this year. Always looking to connect with anyone who is inspired and impassioned by the work they do in this world and is looking to get the message out. That's what this program is all about. Gonna go to a quick music break, play a track by Thelonious Monk, and then on the other side of that, we'll be back with tonight's guest, Marianne Szlyk. Stay tuned.
Thank you. back to Songs of Selah here on 17 Numa Radio. That was Crepsicle with Nelly by Thelonious Monk. And we have a few more tracks lined up to play throughout the next couple of hours. But as of now, I want to invite tonight's guest on. Marianne Szlyk is a professor of English and reading at Montgomery College. She also edits The Song Is, a blog sign for poetry and prose inspired by music, especially jazz. Her book, On the Other Side of the Window, is now available on Amazon. A poem of hers also appeared in issue 3 of Young Raven's Literary Review. Her poems have also appeared in Of With, Bird's Thumb, Lock Raven Review, One Sentence Poems, Solidigo, Sycorax Review, Redbird's Chapbooks Weekly Read, Music of the Aztecs, and Resurrection of a Sunflower, an anthology of work responding to Vincent van Gogh's art. She invites you to stop by her blog sign and perhaps even submit some poems. That's at thesongis.blogspot.com. Marianne, thanks for joining the program tonight. How are you doing?
Great. I'm doing well. Thank you for inviting me, Scott.
Absolutely. Great to talk with you here tonight. Hopefully learn a little bit more about your work and what inspires you in the poetry fields. And I guess here in the Georgia area, schools started back up today. What's the
Oh, my gosh.
How much longer do you have before things kick off?
Actually, I have about a month until classes start. I have the week of meetings before that.
Ah, okay. You're in the D.C. area, is that right?
Yes, in the D.C. area. I teach in Rockville, Maryland, and it's about maybe 15 miles north of D.C. And D.C. itself is big in area as well as in population.
How long have you been teaching there at Montgomery College?
Since 2005.
Okay.
So I guess it'll be 14 or 15 years.
Nice little tenure there so far.
Yeah,
is that something that you had always planned on doing or were inspired to do, or what propelled you
down that path? Oh, yeah.
It was
something I always wanted to do. In fact, I went back to school so that I could teach. And the reason I chose my grad school, Purdue University, I thought that was the best place to learn how to teach because they have a really good, they have a world-renowned rhetoric and composition department. So if you're going to learn how to teach, you're going to learn how to teach at Purdue.
What were some of the things that you learned there that have really been applicable to what you give to your students now?
Well, that's where I learned how to teach in a computer classroom, and I think that's an excellent place to teach because the students can write, they can pre-write, they can revise. You know, they can do a lot of work. It's not just sitting and listening. Also, another thing, you know, I really learned about the writing process there. I learned that I really like teaching the research paper. I didn't teach technical writing there, but you know, I'm teaching it now. So,
talking about the writing process, I guess let's get into yours a little bit. Where did you first start getting inspired, or when, I should say, did you first start getting inspired by poetry? Is that something you've had since you were young, or did that develop over time?
Oh, yeah, since I was young. You know, it really comes and goes. I was actually, before I could really write, I was dictating stories to my grandmother, and she would write them down. Then, you know, I wrote when I was in high school and college, and the first time I went to grad school. Then I stopped writing poetry for a while. I weren't really one to get down to business and, you know, focus on my career or careers. And finally, I started back writing poetry when my parents moved out of their house up in Maine. They retired up to Maine. And my husband and I found a box of my old writings, and hey, they're not bad. So maybe, you know, I could start writing again. You know, I was looking for more of a creative outlet, and writing seemed to be it.
So when you stopped writing that first time, was it something that you were able to completely put out of your mind for the years in between? And then once you refound those poems and got inspired again, did it come back pretty quickly or naturally?
Oh, yeah. Came back pretty quick. You know, I took a course at the Writing Center in Bethesda with Reuben Jackson, and, you know, he had prompts. You know, we listened to a lot of jazz, and he had prompts that really got me going, and he was very supportive. So, you know, that really got me started. Probably if I had had another teacher, I'd be playing the piano now or painting or something.
A minute ago when you mentioned careers in the plural, what other paths have you been down in life?
Well, at one point I wanted to work in editing, but, you know, basically all the editing I did, you know, editing my supervisor's writing. For a while I wanted to be a social worker in a nursing home, but that didn't work out. I worked as an administrative assistant at a university, and that really wasn't for me. So I decided, you know, I thought about what I really liked doing. I liked showing people how to actually, you know, use computers. And I thought, hey, you know, maybe it'd be fun to go back to teaching. I'm going to take a drink. My voice is not sounding what I want. It's sounding very gravelly right now.
So what is it that keeps bringing you back to poetry after taking the time off and then coming back to it? What is it about that art form that really catches you?
Well, Yusuf Komunyakaa talks about his poetry being word pictures, and that's something that really resonated me. It's a, you know, an opportunity for me to you know, sketch in words about different places, people, you know, explore myself, explore nature, you know, express my concerns for the environment, you know, a lot of things. I feel like that, you know, poetry is my medium.
And those themes about environment and settings, different settings that you're in, are those prominent in your most recent book, On the Other Side of the Window?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I would say that book, it's kind of a mix of everything. There are, I have several sections in the book, and actually, I think probably each of the sections could be its own chapbook. The first section is looking out at Earth, and that's not Earth the way we spell it, but it's Bill McKinnon's EAARTH, and now those are my environmental poems. Nature on the Other Side of the Glass, I guess, you know, nature poetry, not, you know, there's politics there, but it's not as overt. Between Two Worlds, it's more about the transitions, and I have, you know, I have poems about art, poems about music, places. The more personal poems are in Always Looking at the Past, Sometimes Living by the River. So really, On the Other Side of the Window has everything, and it's, you know, I think it's pretty well organized. Conversely, in my first print book, I Dream of Empathy, the theme was more empathy, you know, empathy for others and myself. And in the anthology that I was in, you know, Music of the Aztecs, that's an anthology that my writing group in D.C. put together. I think probably my theme there was just, you know, a lot of new poems. I tried to get a lot of new work because actually On the Other Side of the Window, when did that come out? Actually not that long ago, but it is 2018. But I have more, you know, poems that I had written in 2016 and 2017.
What is the process like for you when you're planning out a book? You said in that one you have more themes collected throughout it. How do you decide what you're going to do with each book?
Well, with I Dream of Empathy, what really jumped out was this exercise that I did at the DC Poetry Project, which was a writing group that Michael Anthony Ingram used to run. And he gave us a prompt, and the prompt was to write a poem with the title, I Dream of Empathy. And that prompt really got me thinking beyond just writing the poem. It also got me thinking, well, you know, how can I show empathy through poetry? Also, I think at the time, some researcher had come out with the idea that studying literature, reading literature, especially the novel, encourages one to feel empathy. So, you know, that really intrigued me because, you know, oh, yeah, there's a real purpose to literature. So, you know, I was thinking along those lines. With On the Other Side of the Window, originally I think it began more focused on nature poems, although as my husband says, you know, for a nature poet, I'm the most indoorsy. But and, you know, actually because I think there was, you know, several years in between I Dream of Empathy and On the Other Side of the Window, you know, I just started including more poems, and then my friend Catfish was encouraging me to add more poems, so the book is the length that it is. And probably, you know, to go back to my first book, which is Listening to Electric Cambodia, Looking Up at Trees of Heaven, which is available online. You know, at that time I was writing mostly poems that responded to music, you know, following along from Reuben Jackson's workshop. So, you know, I wanted a book with a more musical theme. And oddly enough, I'm putting together a new book for Pony One Dog Press, I hope. And I'm mostly looking at new poems and hoping that a theme will emerge.
Just playing it by ear right now to see what is inspired and comes up.
Yeah, because I have more new poems than I thought I had. So,
what is your routine when you're writing, and how do you balance your time during semesters when school is in session? Do you write still during school years, or is that done in between?
Oh, it's done in between. The only times that I write during the semester would be if I manage to get out to a workshop or if I'm organizing a workshop. So I mainly write in the summer and in the fall. I mean, excuse me, the summer and the winter. And that act, you know, it adds some anxiety because there are times during the summer I feel like I'm not writing. You know, this is my time to write. Why am I not writing? But today, you know, when I was looking through some poems for Pony One Dog Press, oh my God, I didn't realize I had written so many poems this summer.
Well, yeah, I'm sure that's a good feeling knowing that the stockpile is building up more than you thought.
Yeah.
When you're in one of those moments with the anxiety feeling that maybe things aren't coming as fast as you would like, what are some of the tips that you have for dealing with that, or writer's block, as I guess people sometimes call it? Do you have any sort of go-tos that help you out of that state?
Well, actually, recently I've been looking at a website that this fellow named Zebulon, I forget his last name, that he has put together with prompts. And, you know, he has some interesting prompts. Also, you know, I listen to music. Lately, I've been looking at my photos that I have from a recent trip that I took, and that's been helping me. I look at artwork online. You know, I'm pretty connected online. I guess I sometimes joke around to people that as a poet, I'm from the internet. So those are things that I do. You know, also I think when I'm sitting down to write, I tend to write in the morning. So, you know, I really try to focus my day so that I can write new stuff in the morning. Then, you know, I'll do a little revising first, and then I'll launch it. Also, you know, sometimes, you know, to get myself started, you know, I'm not going to do this in the morning, but, you know, during the day, I'll go for a walk. That helps me out. You know, I go to the park near our house. You know, I've written a number of poems about that park, and you know, that'll get me started.
I can certainly relate to that. It's something I try to do as much as possible as well. Get up to one of the local parks here. It's great to get out in nature and just let the fresh air sort of rejuvenate things. When you're doing your first drafts, do you write by hand or is that on computer?
Oh, by hand.
Very nice.
And sometimes, you know, I will write a second, maybe even a third draft by hand, you know, as the poem takes shape, and then I'll go to the computer. And, you know, my poems will really change as they take shape. Let me think about a good example. From I start with the bigger picture, and I tend to narrow the poem down.
So mostly when you're editing, it's sort of fine-tuning and bringing it into a sharper focus, you think?
Yes, adding more details. You know, for example, in a recent poem, I was writing about a graffiti art tour that I took, or actually a street art tour that I took, and I was including everything, you know, in it. I was even including after the tour when I was walking to the subway and I saw this house that was a wooden house, and I was kind of surprised because, you know, when you're in Brooklyn, you think about brownstones. But, you know, as I was writing, I, you know, took things out. I think probably the first thing I took out was the wooden house. You know, I saved that for another poem. So, I'm taking things out. I'm adding details. You know, sometimes I put poems into, you know, form. You know, in fact, there was another poem that I was working on recently. I had written it as a free verse poem, and it was kind of all over the place. And I felt much better about it once I turned it into a 5/4 poem, which is a form that Tad Richards taught me. It's a syllabic verse.
And when you're going through and have got a few edits out of the way, how do you know, is there an aha moment when it's all come together and you know that the poem is complete?
Yeah, I think so. But, you know, sometimes, you know, I'll go back to the poem and I'll change it around. But there was another poem that I've been working on recently, and I thought that I had the aha moment, but, you know, I let it sit for a while, and I took out quite a lot to focus it.
You were talking a little bit earlier about some of the workshops that you attend or that you put on yourself. What have some of those been, and what are the themes of those workshops?
Well, I'm really thrilled that we were able to get Reuben Jackson to come to Montgomery College. And his theme was on writing about a life that you didn't have. Like alternative personal history.
That's a nice angle.
And that worked out really well. We had a ton of people at that workshop. Sandy Leibowitz came down from New York, and she gave a workshop on writing speculative poetry, mostly fantasy. She showed us images of various mythic figures and tarot cards. So, that was really inspiring. Let's see. This is not a workshop, but I took a class with Claudia Gary on meter, and that's been very influential. I'm trying to add more meter into my poetry.
And do you have any new workshops planned for this upcoming year or the rest of 2019?
Yeah, we've got to figure things out, but we're hoping to do a nature poetry hike with John McDonald, who's a member, and he's a poet in Maryland. He was on Michael's show. And also, I think in October, Ethan and I are going to be, Ethan's my husband, we're going to be leading a workshop on writing and the environment. We even hope to bring in a special guest, a chemistry professor and environmentalist, because the theme for Humanities Days, which this workshop is part of, is the meeting of STEM and humanities.
That nature workshop sounds particularly exciting. Sounds like a great time.
It's going to be in a beautiful park in Maryland, Seneca Creek, and I've been on John's poetry hike before. It's really enjoyable. It's probably more strenuous, so we're also going to have a separate workshop for people who aren't up for the hike. But yeah, it should be good.
And I'd come across something recently when I was getting ready for this interview called the It Takes a Community event that you put on with your husband. Is that along with the workshop, or is that something different?
Yeah, actually, that's the venue for the workshop.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how long have you all been doing that?
Actually, only a year. But, we've been busy. We've had different workshops. We've also led different, it's not just bringing in all these people to lead the workshops. I led one workshop where we faced different directions and we wrote about, what came up for us as maybe we faced north or east or south or west. There was also another workshop, actually, Ethan led a workshop, and I led a workshop. Oh, actually, Ethan's workshop was at It Takes a Community, and that was on the elements, earth, air, fire, and water. And I did a similar workshop at Writers on the Green Line, which is in D.C.,
Have you always lived there in D.C., or where are some of the other places?
Traveled? We moved to Washington, D.C. in 2002. Before that, I was going to grad school in Indiana. I lived in Boston for most of my adult life, for 2.5 years in Eugene, Oregon, and about a year in New York City. And before that, I grew up in Shrewsbury, Massachusetts, which is a suburb of Worcester, Massachusetts, which is a city that is not Boston in Massachusetts.
With the with your journey in poetry, well, more specifically, I wanted to get in, I guess, to the music, how that plays a role in your work. You've touched on the idea of jazz already in the interview, and that plays a dominant role at your website, the song is, as well. So I wonder, where did jazz come into your life, and how does that influence your poetry?
Although I listened to jazz before, I would say my husband. You know, he is really into it. He's really knowledgeable about jazz. He doesn't play it, but he studied it. He even took a grad school course on the history of jazz. He worked with Yusuf Komunyakaa. And, you know, we go to concerts. We go to different people's concerts. And I think that got me really involved. You know, but I did listen to the music before. My family listened to a lot of music. I was in a chorus, even though I don't sing very well. Probably the first thing I bought once I had a job. In fact, I think I got a job with my father so that I could buy a little stereo, and that was always very important to me. So I would say that's what made music so important to me.
Do you listen to music as you're writing?
Sometimes. Especially when I'm getting started, and it tends to be more instrumental. Although I have written poems about people who write song lyrics. And I think I've written a number of poems inspired by Gene Clark. Not that I'm plagiarizing him. Not that I'm trying to write in his vein, but these poems are my response to listening to his work.
We have a Gene Clark track that you had sent along. We'll play that
later
in the episode. Who are some of the other artists, whether musicians or some of the other poets that have inspired you through the years?
Okay. I enjoy... As I've mentioned, I enjoy reading Yusuf Komunyakaa. As a poet, early on, I really liked the work of Robert Lowell. Especially after life studies. That my first professor, Jane Shore, had actually studied with him. She'd studied with Elizabeth Bishop, so I was, I guess, raised on Elizabeth Bishop as a poet. And I guess if you're raised on Elizabeth Bishop, indirectly you're raised on Marianne Moore. Poets now, one of the best books that I've read recently was Abdul Ali's Trouble Sleeping. I've been to his workshops too. He always comes up with really good prompts. So let's see, some other poets, Tara Betts, Break the Habit is a really good book. So these are poets who've really intrigued me. Music. Well, of course, I guess I've always listened to the Beatles, and they've always kind of been there. I discovered this really cool album by Larry Young, who's a jazz musician, Lawrence of Newark, and that listening to that album really intrigued me. when I'm grading papers, though, I like listening to Art Blakey because he keeps me awake.
What was the, what was the decision and the time frame around when you started the song is?
Actually, at that, you know, it had a very brief life as a place for me to repost my poetry. Then, you know, I realized, well, you know, I think it would be more interesting to start a magazine, you know, to start a blog zine. And so I said, well, you know, what theme will I have? And the theme, around that time, Bohemian Caverns was still open. We went to a concert by Ron Carter, the bassist, and you know, I was thinking there are all these poems about, you know, people like Charlie Parker and John Coltrane, you know, the classics, the people born in the 10s and the 20s. And what about newer people? What about the people who are playing now? And so I began the song is, as you know, the first contest I had, I wanted people to send in poems inspired by musicians who were born from 1937 on. You know, 1937 does not sound that young, but I guess because Ron Carter had inspired me, I decided to start with him. And you know, I received a number of poems. I remember the poem by the woman who won the contest that she was writing about Laurie Williams, who is a singer who's active in Europe and in Washington D.C. You know, so is somebody who was quite active. She might even be younger than I am. And Let me call up the song is so I can look at some of the people in the first contest.
Those contests are really interesting. I'm sure that helps you to come across, as you just mentioned, new artists that you get to
and
go and check out yourself.
Actually, I think probably it might be better for new poets as well, because I think for the most part, people are maybe not as adventurous musically. You know, there have been some people, like, you know, when Felino A. Soriano was still alive, I was always amazed at what he would come up with. You know, that he introduced me to Robert Glasper, for example. You know, Robert Glasper is this great young musician. And he would come up with all sorts of people. Let's see, at some point I had a tribute to him right around the time, I think it might have been in October, maybe, of maybe 20.
Felino was always sort of the master at the jazz impressions,
yeah.
In his poetry, had that unique style of sort of dancing across the page with the spacing in between, sort of got you in that flow of whatever he must have been listening to at the time.
Yeah, and you know he was so young. Well, I guess, you know, he's a bit younger than I am. So I guess I think of him as being young.
Do you have any current contests that you're thinking about or have upcoming?
Well, actually, we're on hiatus because the last contest I went through about three or four judges. So, you know, I just thought, you know, this is, I think we're burnt out. I think, but I think probably the next one, next contest I would do would probably be about musicians born in the 1960s.
That'll be an interesting one. Yeah, like that.
Yeah,
idea.
That would be. I know one comes to, you know, Danilo Perez. He's the first one to come who comes to mind. Not, you know, not
yeah.
sure about, you know, some of the others don't come to mind. But, you know, I'm looking at, you know, the tribute to Foligno and, you know, I think I had heard V.J. Ear before. You know, he wrote a poem inspired by V.J. Ear, Tekuya Kuroda, Chris Bowers, who, you know, very, very, very young. You know, and, of course, Robert Glasper. Thelonious Monk, yes. Also Jason Moran. So, and, you know, Christian Scott. So he was great for, you know, coming up with people to write about, you know, other than, you know, the usual suspects.
The song is, you say it's on hiatus right now.
I'm still publishing new work. You know, some of it is about music, some of it isn't. So, you know, I'm always happy to publish new people. I'm always happy to publish people who are returning. And, you know, whatever you want to write about, you know, especially if you want to write about music. I think, you know, that at one point, you know, there were people who were right, you know, I think A.J. Huffman sent in a poem about 80s music, and that's really not my thing. But, you know, that's fine. It was a very good poem. I think it might even have won one of the contests. So, you know, definitely. You know, I may, because the semester is always crazy, I may not be publishing regularly, but I am still publishing.
Okay, so still always accepting submissions.
Oh, yeah.
If there's anyone out
yeah.
there in the audience, they can find the link to the song is in the show description box. There's a link there, and hopefully go check out some of that work that you're talking about right now and hope maybe send you some of their own if they're so inclined.
Yeah.
Are you also still an associate editor at the Potomac Review?
Oh, yeah, I am.
What does that involve there, and how did you get associated with them?
Well, actually, I was associate editor before I started writing it. Well, you know, when you apply for a job, especially when you apply for a job as a professor, you put down everything that you've done. And at the time, I had an office near the woman who was the editor-in-chief, and she was looking for people to read poetry, and I fit the bill. So, you know, that's how I became involved. Mainly, it involves, you know, reading through the submissions and passing them on, you know, the ones that work onto the poetry editor and those that don't work onto the editor-in-chief so that he can send them the thanks but no thanks. I do proofreading as well. And at one point I was also writing book reviews, but actually of short stories. But, you know, that was a while ago.
You're definitely wearing a lot of hats. It must be difficult to manage your time with all those different things going on.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there are some things that suffer.
That's the way life is. Gotta pick and choose priorities. So I'm hoping that you have some poems from either of your books that you'd like to read tonight. And I was thinking
yeah.
maybe we'll go to one of these other tracks that you sent, one by Dr. Lonnie Smith. We'll play that and then come back and do some of your poems.
Okay, sounds like a good plan.
All right, well, we will be back on the other side of this short break. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in this evening. Thank you. Selah. That was Dr. Lonnie Smith with Tropicalia. And we are here tonight with guest Marianne Szlyk, who is going to, I believe, read some poems for us now.
Yeah. I'd like to actually start with Crepuscle with Callie. And that actually has an interesting backstory. That I wrote it after my husband suggested that I write a poem about our cat Callie's worst nightmare, which is to be in a house with multiple cats. She's a very jealous cat. And in fact, the first few years, our cat Thelma was living with us. You know, they're both living together now. It was tension, and I went, they were fighting, Callie was the instigator, and I was looking at pictures from those days, and, you know, Callie was nasty, and a house with many, many, many cats would have been the house of the jazz baroness, Thelonious Monk's patron. And I remember watching a documentary, and Monk claimed that she had 200 cats, you know, which I hope was an exaggeration. I don't know how big her house was.
Yeah, that's pushing it.
yeah. You know, even if it's Buckingham Palace, which I don't think it was. But anyways. Here's my poem about Callie. Waves of scent wash over her. Urine, human and animal, sweat, damp wool, bad coffee, no cream, worse cigarettes, a perfume called joy. A landscape quakes. Calico, tuxedo, gray, orange, white, black, tabby, Manx, the notes on the record skip as the landscape shimmers and shifts. Chase or be chased, nip or be nipped, lick or be licked. The other cats multiply. They leap onto counters and crowd around windows. Lights twinkle with kindness out there. Inside, the cats multiply, sniffing at cold coffee cups and ashtrays, chasing, nipping, licking. Behind the last door, the man in the suit and hat will not stir. He barely breathes. They say that one night he played the piano with his elbows while the sax wailed like a car alarm from the future. Another night he did not play at all. If she were herself, she'd rattle the blinds until he awoke and let her out of this nightmare. He doesn't have to play the piano for her. Just get her out. Again, the landscape shifts. The record skips. Beyond the last door, Callie still seeks the threads of her waking life. No coffee, no cigarettes, no chasing, nipping, licking. The presence of real joy. Okay.
Very nice. This has Callie mellowed out over the years and become more accustomed to the intruder?
Oh, yeah. Earlier in the show, Callie was on the couch with Thelma, and, you know, very, very peaceful. Very peacefully they were on the couch together. Not like, you know, the pictures from 7 or 8 years ago.
It's good that they've formed a bond. It makes things easier.
The age of 15 or 16.
Yeah, I guess we tend to mellow out as the years pass by.
Mm. Some of us.
Right. So you have any more poems you'd like to read?
Oh, yeah, sure. I'm thinking, since I read a poem about Callie, I'd like to read one about Thelma.
Okay, sounds good.
Yeah, and this is from On the Other Side of the Window. It was originally written for an anthology of poems inspired by Pet Sounds. I'm not a big Beach Boys fan, but I really liked this one instrumental, and that was Let's Go Away for a While. And ironically, I sent the poems to the wrong address, so the poem was published someplace else, but it's also published in my book. So Let's Go Away for a While. Thelma and her husband sing along to Pet Sounds when driving to the Cape. Jerry Cole's guitar begins, "Wouldn't it be nice?" And they launch into song, his voice too wild, hers with the Texas accent she can never lose. They plunge in, splashing past strip malls and swamp. But this instrumental is the song she loves best. The vibraphone like sunshine against drums like surf. The horns like the wave that crashes furthest onto the rocks, not quite the highway. The strings are clouds, meringue she has whipped up in a stainless steel bowl at home. She almost forgets that the East Coast has weak surf, and slimy seaweed clings to waders' calves in warm, knee-high water as she and her husband waddle in among the thin girls from Boston. She then remembers cold, cloudy Mondays when the two of them drive back home, listening to their inland music, Chicago blues, Texas swing, Hank Williams, honky tonkin', the old songs that better suit their voices. Maybe she likes that this instrumental comes before anyone can see the bridge or the traffic. Or she likes to catch her breath before Sloop John B's lyrics grind her down like the refrain of a whiny child. She catches her breath.
I like that.
Thanks.
You'll be able to keep the peace at the house tonight. Read an ode to both of them so no one can get jealous.
Right, exactly. Exactly.
So if there's anyone out there who would like to call in with any questions for Marianne or to read a few poems of your own, the number here is 646-668-8757, and the phone lines are open. And we'll hear a few more poems from Marianne as well.
Okay, great. Yeah, I think, you know, you mentioned that I gave you the Gene Clark. I want to read a poem that I guess it's an alternative history. It's one of my alternative history poems. It's a poem imagining him as an old man. He died when he was middle-aged, 1991. But this is Alternative History in Stanton, Virginia. And I'm imagining him in this cool little town, little city of Stanton, Virginia. The man who sings my favorite song wanders the streets of this small city. He no longer carries his guitar, too heavy for walking past 70, on uneven brick sidewalks that all run uphill. An ex-smoker, he catches his breath beneath the marquee of the last one-screen movie theater, the one that used to show movies he liked. It reeks of buttered popcorn. He moves on, past the site of the old Woolworths, the one that sold his records back when they were hits, when they crept out of open windows, even in this mountain town, before they clung to him, never leaving the room with the reel-to-reel tape. Never leaving home. Okay.
Those alternative history poems are an interesting idea. Did you ever write any about your own life in that vein?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Actually, let me read a new poem. It's too new to be in a book, and it is it's the poem from Reuben Jackson's workshop. It was published in Virgin, which is Gregory Luce is the poetry editor. He's a local poet. And let's see, the one I want is Flying into Warsaw in Another Life. And my father's father was Polish, and yet he did not grow up in what's now Poland, but I'll read this poem. Flying into Warsaw in Another Life. In this life, the eastbound airplane simply hangs above the toy landscape. Cotton ball clouds, tiny nameless trees, the ocean, a smooth dark sheet without trash or fish or shipwreck. Tomorrow morning, I land in Poland, my grandfather's country, country of trees with yellowed leaves and peeling bark, of cobblestones coated with cigarette smoke, of lumbering oxen and steam trains, of people who look like me, but swish and swallow vinegary consonants that burn going down an American's throat. In this life, I don't know that Grampy never lived in Poland. In his own village near Vilnius, his words, a foreign language, swirled like wood smoke in morning air.
Nice poem. Thank you.
Thanks, yeah. I think maybe if I have time, I'll read. I'll read a poem about the park, and this is probably one of my first poems that has some meter, and I hope that it's apparent when I read it. Maryville Park, 2019. A red-winged blackbird hangs and sways on last year's reed. Gray fluff still clings. New reeds unfurl. Not yet quite tall for this or any other bird who swoops and calls in flight. A deer stalks through the swamp, but I await last summer's turtle, creature that I mistook for stone. The minnow's school is bustling, downstream past empty bottles of water and tropical fantasy from our lottery stores. The left behind, one fish flirts with rocks, with bottles' mouths. I wonder what will remain here as climate changes, as oceans rise. Mosquitoes rising from algae bloom. Trim women walking robot dogs they will not outlive. Young men guzzling soda and dropping bottles in the swamp as deer slip in and track this path. Okay.
I like the imagery in that one. The robot dog.
Yeah, it's good balance. It's a good balance because I know, you know, when you're writing, when you're trying to use meter, you really have to concentrate. You know, I find that I'm always looking up words at how many syllables is this? I want to see what the stress actually is.
How do you feel that your poetry has changed through the years? Have there been any metamorphoses that it's gone through that you can look back on and see to where it is now?
Well, when I started writing, and when I was writing in college, I wrote free verse. But I've gone through some, you know, various forms. I would count words. I would write poems, and each line was maybe six words or five words, maybe seven words long. I would do a lot of three-line stanza poems. Tad Richards taught me the 5-4 poem, which is syllabic. And, you know, the haiku, I think, is too short for me, but the 5-4 is just right. It's five stanzas, and it's a pattern of five syllables, four syllables, six syllables, three, and then so on, in a kind of chain. And, you know, now I've progressed to trying to incorporate meter in my poems. So I would say, and I think of the subject, my poems are, you know, become deeper and deeper exploration. I'm writing more poems about my father's side of the family. I'd like to write more poems about Worcester, about Shrewsbury, where I grew up. I think when I started out, I was writing poems about Oregon because, you know, basically I associated that part of my life with poetry, and also poems about New York. New York is just so interesting. Even though I didn't live there very long, I've written a ton of poems set there.
Short but inspiring stay.
It has dramatic moments. And I guess I'm writing more. I think I'm writing more first person. For a while, when I started, I would write a lot of third person poems. I would write a lot of persona poems, you know, poems in the voice of fictional characters. But now, I think probably the last fictional persona I've done has been Thelma. And she's my cat, so I'm not doing as many persona poems as I used to.
Number here in the studio is 646-668-8757. If there's anyone that would like to call in this evening, we're talking with Marianne Szlyk. And I wanted to also ask you about any major mentors that you've had throughout your life, whether it was family or other role models that you think have had the most profound influence on the direction of your life, whether it's with poetry or your teaching or just in general of the life that you've lived?
Well, I would say probably, both of my parents in different ways. And, you know, also my grandmother. You know, maybe my grandmother is the reason that I don't drive. That, she didn't drive, so I guess, you know, I followed along in that path. My mother was a teacher. She taught math. I teach English, but and my father was, you know, he was more interested in the arts. He played piano. You know, he even wrote a little, but, you know, he was more likely to play piano or to paint. In fact, we took art classes together when I was in high school, and, you know, he was a lot better than I was.
Well, that's great that you had that encouragement from a young age.
You know, that kept me going through some dark periods, some tough periods. I would even say, you know, maybe my first husband was kind of a mentor, because, you know, I was looking, and I guess, you know, I experienced a lot of things. I was interested in a lot of things because of him. You know, it's not just my second husband, you know, who introduced me to jazz and everything, but, you know, my first husband introduced me to some things as well. I think maybe this might be a good time to read a poem that's in the other side of the window. It's maybe a poem that I wouldn't necessarily want him to hear, but it's When I Was Marianne Moore, if I can find it. I think it's in... Okay, that might not be the title. I thought I had it in the... thought it was in this book. Oh, it's
maybe
in Tale November. That's the. It has another title. I always think of it as the poem is, you know, it's When I Was Marianne Moore, but that's not the actual title. Okay, in Pale November. When I was Marianne Moore, wearing a black straw hat, we wandered through the woods he knew too well. Leafless trees clutched at the faded sky. Stones and fallen branches littered the ground. I listened to his youthful harangue and watched for birds and plants she would have seen. But it was long past time for even poison ivy or bittersweet berries. So he and I drifted until the early dark pooled at our feet to freeze and trip us like the branches, stones, and fallen leaves that always cling to pale November. For years, beginning with that month, I listened to his middle-aged litany and ignored the leather-bound books she wove into her poetry. Following the sound of his voice into and through the woods and out the other side, to the early darkness, the evergreen trees, the stray cats, the bus stop signs like clenched fists, to the long ride on empty buses back to the city we always returned to. Walking through Rock Creek Park in November, having left the city I always returned to, I count syllables the way she did. I try to remember his voice. Okay. So it's maybe not the necessary. Oh, go
you
ahead.
Said that, you said that's a piece from On the Other Side of the Window?
Yes, it's on page 80, 81 of On the Other Side of the Window. Yeah, it's probably, I think in its way it was a pivotal piece. You know, I was writing about my life in a different way and, you know, covering maybe some of the things I didn't feel too keen about.
That therapeutic process. How do you, when you're writing about other people or situations that you've been in, as you mentioned, you said it might not be one that you would want him to hear.
Yeah.
When you're writing about other people, how much of a impact does that have on your process of what other people might think about it, or if they read into it too much, thinking it's about them, or that sort of thing?
You know, I try not to name names. You know, and in fact, I remember he said that he didn't want me to use his real name if I wrote. And this was years ago when I was writing fiction. You know, I don't really write about my brother. You know, I think maybe here and there I've mentioned him, but you know, he doesn't really appear, and you know, we are estranged. You know, he's estranged from my father and me. You know, in some ways it's easier to write about somebody who's gone. You know, And maybe, you know, I have a number of poems about my mother. And in some ways, she's maybe easier to write about, not just because she passed away, but also, as my husband says, she was an extreme character. But, you know, I guess I try to be true to the experience. There are some, but as I said, there are some people I hope that they don't read my poems.
And what has your overall response been from family members and friends since you started publishing poetry?
Oh, my family's positive. You know, that I just gave a couple of my books to my aunt, and she was very excited. You know, I can imagine how excited she'll be when she sees the poem that mentions her husband, you know, but, you know, it's a nice sweet poem, you know, about memories of, you know, riding in the back seat while my father and my uncle were speaking Polish and going off to look at tractors. But, you know, that's the nice heartwarming memory, I guess, that everybody wants to be written about. My ex-husband has been, you know, just like my husband has been supportive of my poetry. I have writer friends, you know, who are support, you know, people I knew before I started writing who have been supportive for the most part. And, you know, there are people who haven't been supportive. But, you know, nobody's been criticizing my version. You know, I have no idea if my brother is that. I highly doubt he's read any of my poems. I suspect... Oh, go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. You can continue. Didn't mean to interrupt you.
It is interesting with my ex that I think he was very positive about I Dream of Empathy. I think I gave him a PDF copy of On the Other Side of the Window. He really liked the nature poems, but he didn't mention the others. You know, about my life, because, you know, of course, I went over my marriage. You know, that there are a couple, you know, nice sweet poems, but, you know, at the time when I was writing the poems, I was more interested in therapy and catharsis and all that. You know, I was kind of angry at him. Although I think, you know, I'm less angry at him now, you know, that we're actually in touch on Facebook.
That's
so
good. Maybe
the writing
process itself might have helped to alleviate some of that and bring it into a new perspective. It's definitely a therapeutic art.
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, recognizing that there are some things I owe to him. You know, my life probably would be very different if I hadn't met him, or if, you know, we had broken up relatively early.
And you had mentioned a little bit earlier in the program that you were hoping to put out another book sometime soon. Who was the publisher with that, and where are you at in the process of that book?
This is Pony One Dog, and they're out of D.C. I'm just gathering poems that I would include, and, you know, I haven't even shown my husband the poems that I'm thinking of including. So, you know, it's at a fairly early stage. And,
okay,
you know,
wait.
Definitely Maryvale Park 2019 is going to be in that book.
Very nice. Everything comes along at its own pace, and I'm sure that book
yeah.
will be just the same, and things will work out well with that. We've mentioned Gene Clark a couple times throughout the show, so I thought maybe this would be a good time to play the track you sent by him, and if we get any callers on the other side, we'll go to them, and if not, we'll close out the show with a couple more poems from you after this break, if that sounds good to you.
Okay, sounds like a good plan.
All right, good deal. So we're going to go to Gene Clark, and this is his track, In a Misty Morning. We'll be back on the other side.
Morning. like the clouds above the storm, just had to cry. I trained my eyes on a police cruiser. I walked.
Here on 17 Numa Radio, and that was Gene Clark in A Misty Morning. We're here tonight with Marianne Szlyk, who's been a great guest. I want to thank you for being on the program tonight and for sharing your poems with us. And here in the last segment, I was hoping that you had a couple more maybe that you could close the show out for us with.
Okay, yeah, I'm on my 202 number.
Yeah, I've got you switched over.
Yeah, my not quite landline was running out of gas, so
okay.
Or running out of juice. Yeah, actually, I thought this would probably be a good time to read a poem about my mother, and I think this poem is not a sweet, lovely little poem. Kind of shows her, you know, what my husband refers to as her extreme character. This is in the Music of the Aztecs. If my mother is in purgatory, she is a stewardess flying through turbulence, never crashing, never landing. Her skirt is too short, showing each half pound creeping onto her small frame. She cannot stop to pull down her skirt or reapply her makeup or fix her hair or even drink coffee. The passengers plead for more drinks, for more pillows, more peanuts, more sick bags. Customers call for more quiet as babies and grown men howl as fat women pray to Jesus without a rosary. She rolls her eyes, correcting everyone's grammar in her mind. Her co-workers are friends. They roll their eyes as voices lowered. They discuss the passengers while they stock the cart. They give everyone nicknames. They have nicknames for co-workers too. They can't find pillows. They fill the cart with blankets or raincoats or sticky uniforms. They can't find Dramamine. They raid their purses for M&Ms, breath mints, or hard candy. Someday this plane will land. My mother swears that she will go back to Maine and never leave. Her friends and family will all have to find her there.
Okay. Very nice. Correcting everyone's grammar in her mind.
Even though she's a math teacher. And actually, you know, my mother was very anti planes. You know, and in fact, the only time she willingly went on a plane was to go to Ireland, where her family was from.
Oh, wow. So
yeah.
She was anti-planes, and then you are anti-car?
Yeah. I'm anti-planes as well. You know, if Amtrak doesn't go there, I'm not going.
Before you close out with one more poem, I did have another question I wanted to ask you about your teaching. What is it that you most want to inspire in the students that you teach? And when they leave one of your classes at the end, what do you hope that you've imparted in them or that they take away from it?
I think probably the one thing I want to inspire is for them to follow their interest. And, you know, I teach a lot of the research paper, and one assignment that I do is the iSearch paper, and that is a paper where you're not pursuing an argument, but you are exploring a topic. And, you know, I want people to write about what they're interested, not what they think they should write for me, not what they think is so-called controversial. And, you know, I've gotten some good papers over the years on various topics. And, you know, I remember this is years ago, I had a student who wrote a paper arguing that graffiti was art, although I guess technically probably what he called graffiti was really street art.
I like that advice a lot, to follow your interest. One of my heroes, Joseph Campbell, talked about following your bliss, and I think
getting
into that alignment with what your heart or soul is calling for really sets the path in life. So I think that's a great thing that they can come away with, that you're imparting on them.
Mm.
We do have a caller here.
Ooh.
At area code 630. Caller from 630, are you there?
Oh, I'm just standing here listening.
Okay. Did you have a question for the guest tonight, or?
Oh, actually, I just noticed it on my groups, my Facebook poetry groups, and noticed who it was, and I said, well, you know what? I'm just going to call up and listen for a while.
Well, hey, is this Michael Lee Johnson?
Yeah, it is.
Hey, okay, Michael, how are you doing, man?
Good. I just saw this special guest here, and since I know her and appreciate what she does, what song is, I just couldn't resist. So that's that.
Oh, you should read a poem, Michael.
What's that?
You should read a poem.
I say what?
Read a poem.
Read a poem. Now, wait a
or
minute.
Recite.
If I got people messed up here?
No. Oh, no. We're in the second hour. We're looking for callers.
I know. But who is the main guest tonight?
Marianne Szlyk.
Who's the main? Oh, well, why did I see Song Is on my sites?
Yeah, that's who we're talking with.
Oh, okay. All right. Marianne, right. Okay, I got it. Okay, I'm good. I'm just sitting back here listening for a while. I just saw it and immediately called, and I thought, well, I'll just listen to her talk for a while. I didn't really have time to construct anything. So
okay.
I'm
well,
just listening.
Yeah, she's been on for about the last hour and a half, so we're sort of heading into the home stretch here, but...
Okay, well, I looked up, and, you know, it's 9:30 in the Chicagoland area, so, you know, I saw that it started at 9, but then again, there might be an hour difference depending on, you know, whatever, wherever, so.
Yeah, we got all
anyway,
these times, so, well, what's been going on with you lately? Haven't spoken to you?
Oh, I don't know, not a whole lot, you know, my business has been down and, you know, whatever, but then again, I'm getting old and I don't know if I need to do it anymore. But other than that, I'm not really doing a whole lot. I've got a couple of videos I've been working on, but I'm sort of messed up because I got Windows 10 now, and Windows 7 used to use, what was it called, Movie Maker. And Windows 10 does not allow you to use Movie Maker, so all of a sudden I'm out there looking for a video maker that I can unfortunately have to learn the new software of. Whenever you got to learn new software, it's a problem and time-consuming. So that's what's going on. Mm. Yeah, you know. But anyway, how are you doing, Marianne?
Oh, I'm doing well, thank you. I'm enjoying my vacation, you know, like summer.
Okay. Yeah. You know, and, you know, Song Is ringing a bell right away because I think you nominated me at least once for something.
Yeah.
You know, so as soon as I saw that name, I said, you know, I've got to get hooked up on this. But I really, you know, I was really just planning on sitting back and listening because I didn't have time to create anything, really, you know. But, and I got a couple of new poems, too, I'm working on. But other than that, I'm just trying to get through a sort of a hot day in Chicago, around 90 degrees. It's finally starting to cool off. I find myself sort of demotivated when it gets too hot. I just sort of lose the energy. You know, so I do better
at
night. You know, I live in a condo, so I do have a wall air conditioner in the living room, but nothing in the bedroom.
Oh, that's rough.
Yeah, well, sort of, but you know, I've got a couple of pretty good size fans in there, so I get by all right. But that's it. So you've got a new book, eh?
Well, actually. Yeah, I guess technically speaking, On the Other Side of the Window is new-ish. The Music of the Aztecs, it's an anthology. It's a pretty serious anthology. And, you know, I hope in time I will have another book out.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Well, you know,
A friend has a press, and he was inviting me to send some stuff.
Well, probably, I don't know. I guess my first gut reaction to that is if you have a friend that you know and you trust, it's probably a pretty good idea. It's sort of a motivating factor to try to get started on it.
Mm.
You know, I've got so many things I need to get started on. You know, I mean, several chapbooks I've just been buried with because I spent so much time on my Facebook poetry groups.
Yeah, well, it's a huge group.
Oh, well, I actually have five.
God.
You know, I mean, the contemporary poets, their works and current whatever, it's just one of them, but that is the major one. But I have three or four others as well that I keep in tune with. But, you know, it's sort of time-consuming. And, you know, I don't know. I'm sort of caught between, if I ever get to the chapbook, sort of caught between self-publishing, because I'm sort of well-known. But I've learned a long time ago that solo poets, I don't really care too much how well-known you are. It's a difficult road. You know, it's easier. It's easier for me to put together anthologies where a lot of different people are involved in it. And you pick up a lot of the people that have their poems in it, obviously, but you also pick up others that are in the group, sort of acting as a buying base, you know. You know, but if you go out there, I mean, I'm sure even if I go out, well, I don't know. I guess what I'm really trying to say is, you know, I've been saving up a lot of small publishing poetry. I mean, small, what do you want to call it, small poetry publishers, you know, and I don't know whether I would activate or try to get in with one of those or not, because usually what they're doing is taking a slice of your royalties, you know, or committing you to a term where your poems that are in there are not allowed to be used for a certain period of time. And I don't know if I like that or not, so I don't know. You know, but if it's a publisher that you feel comfortable with and some locally you know, I don't know. I'd probably go for that. So I don't know. But anyway, has anybody else called up yet tonight?
No, we just
you're the first.
Marianne, oh, my goodness. I'm privileged. I didn't even have a shot of vodka to go with this either. That's really disgusting. I just saw her name. You know, I just saw her name and I said, you know, I like her. I got to do this, you know.
No,
so I just picked up the phone. Well, you know what? I was really counting on just sitting back and with the phone to my ear and listening and whatever. But what happened, of course, is I cracked my my computer screen monitor tonight because I was having a smoothie, and I dropped it all over, flipped a spoon up, and cracked the screen. So you know, I'm in a real good mood that way.
Oh no!
Yeah. Yeah, you know. But other than that, really, I was just calling in to listen because I guess I'm a little bit late for listening.
Oh, no,
be...
actually, the first part was more, you know, Scott was asking me questions. And,
right.
You know, it's only been maybe since 10 o'clock that I've been reading poems.
Yeah, okay, and I missed all of those, so I really goofed. I guess when I looked at it on my site, I saw 9 o'clock, and I looked up, and it says 9:30. Ah, about the right time, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But evidently, you started at 8. Well, I don't know. Maybe you started at 9 your time. Maybe that would have been 8 my
time. Yeah, I guess, when I advertised it, I said it was 9 o'clock Eastern time.
Yeah, I probably, I just didn't think.
Because I guess it's possible we may have some people listening from other countries. I know Ryan Quinn Flanagan said that he might be listening from Canada, and I think and Bruce Hodder said that he might be listening from England.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I understand, but I don't have a whole lot other than to say I'd just rather listen to you for a while. But
Again,
I don't know. You know, I'll listen to Scott and you guys talk for a while.
All right. Well. Appreciate you listening in, my friend, and hope that screen issue gets resolved quickly.
No, it's just like a big glob of black ink at the top, and when you touch it, you know, it's digital, so when you touch it, it goes into all kinds of little beautiful little lines that sort of clutter up everything you're trying to read. But I'll get that resolved tomorrow. I'll just have to go and do something about it. The monitors are not too extremely expensive, even they're... They're dumb, you know what I mean? They're not smart, so you can use almost any monitor. So I'll be good with that. Scott, what's going on with you lately?
Oh, just...
If I may ask, if I'm out of line here.
No, you're fine. Working on the next book. Going to be called Songs of Selah, same as this program. And putting together a poetry anthology for Culture Cult Press right now on the theme of hope.
Okay.
Going through those...
Okay.
Poems and, you know, just doing this show.
Formatting takes so much time.
Really fortunately
does.
For me, I get to just read through them and make the decisions, and then Jay
Sacrabarty or somebody else
will
do the formatting. Well, Ken, you know, Ken Allen Drunsfield does that for me. He reads most of the poems. He sends them to me, and I'll take a quick look, but we almost always agree. But then it gets turned over to me to do the formatting, and that becomes more of a nightmare. You know, you get poems from England or some other place that's on the metric system, or something like that, then all of a sudden what's a normal font size or whatever over in England is not the same as the font size I'm using here, because we go by the other system, right? We go by feet and inches and so forth. Believe it or not, Windows 10 is slightly different. All of a sudden you get a sizing issue. You know, then you've got proofs to deal with back and forth with people, you know, and their changes and this, that, and the other. So it takes a lot of effort, you know. Well, Scott, you're using some private publishers too, right? Some private small press? Or not?
Mostly just the small press. I did the last book earlier this year with a press called Cyberwit, and then I've been with Alien Buddha Press for a couple.
Right, Cyber. That's the fellow out of India, correct?
Yeah, Karanush.
There you go. Okay, yeah, and quite a few of I'm going to call our members, because I tend to include Scott as, you know, and Marianne as our members, you know, of my group. But the bottom line is I've noticed that several people have used him in the last year or so. You know.
He does a good job. The main reason I went with him was because the way that he put the covers together. Honestly, I had a book that I wanted to get out quickly, and he had done such a good job with the other people's covers, and then Misty Milwee did the original cover for it, and it all just came together nicely, so I was
Yeah, does he do most of the formatting?
Yeah, I had it in pretty good shape before I sent
it to him.
You had a pretty good
Word doc or a pretty good PDF file.
Yeah, both those that I sent along to him, that I pretty much had it in the final version that I wanted it to be.
Made it easier for
him. Contents.
I did talk to him. I didn't talk to him, but I messaged him several times, and we went back and forth because he wanted to maybe publish something of mine. But, you know, his shipping costs are quite expensive from India. And the other thing that, you know, and I can't blame him for this, you know, he does take a slice of the royalties, you know, where I would make more by self-publishing than by going through him. But you gotta, you know, but nobody does nothing for nothing, and formatting and poetry is a rough go to begin with. So, you know, that's fair. You know what I mean? And some people don't really care about whether they make $10 or $20 or $100 or whatever. They're just want to get it out there. You know what I mean? You know, and that's fair. That's fair.
I think with that particular collection, I just wanted to get a few copies that I could pass around at the events here in Atlanta, and then let him pretty much have all the online sales.
Right. Well, that is important in your case, Scott, because you're out there in the field, I'm going to call it in the field, the poetry field, a lot. You know, a lot more than most poets. You really are.
It goes through phases. I've been kind of in hibernation the last month or so, but I'll get back out there and start burning the trail again.
Yeah, well, you know, I suppose it's like anything else. After a while, it sort of wears at you. You know, you have to revitalize yourself. I've sort of gone through one of those moods myself where I'm not really doing as much as I could be, not as many new poems as I could be putting out. So during those slow times, I'll go back and look or revise some old poems and come back up with a different version of it or something that sort of fills in my time. You know, I've got so many, starter poems stuck in different files that it's pretty easy for me to go back and say, there's a little bit of potential here. When I'm not being really creative, going back and pulling up some of the old starter stuff and taking a look at it and whatever. I tend to go through spaces like that where, you know, I'm just not really putting out anything really, really original. But then again, I don't know if that's true because I've got quite a bit out there.
You do have a lot out there, and you're also always putting all that time and energy and effort into your groups, and we definitely appreciate that, my friend.
Well, you know, I think Scott and I talked about this once, but I don't know. This probably maybe is not the right way of thinking, but I just think, and I think you do this too, Scott, you know, when you get out there, you know, and you stand alone. I mean, you know some of these people, you're a friendly guy, whatever, but you stand alone. You don't know if there's going to be one person out there or 20 people or three. You know, and you spend a lot of time and effort. you know, making these attempts to get poetry out to the world, and I think that's of merit. I just sort of feel like, you know, if you spend time and try your best to help as many people as you can, that you naturally build a certain support system of followers. And that if you spend a little bit of time helping others, I just honestly do believe over time, it creates a mental attitude within yourself that's positive for yourself and others. And hopefully it'll work out time consideration-wise.
I do believe, you know, that. It's a rewarding experience just being in the community itself, and then that has impacts on life overall. So I think I think you hit it on the hill there, on the head there.
Well, you know, believe it or not, some of the ones I enjoy most about Scott is when I see him walking around in his little Georgia woods around there and stuff, and he just sort of semi-babbling to himself and letting his spirit flow. I sort of enjoy those little videos. You know,
those
are so
videos.
Real. They're real and all dirt, you know. They're not prepared too much. They're just, hey, I'm out here. I'm feeling the wind. This is what's going through my hair. This is what's going through my mind. I think that's pretty cool, you know.
Getting out in nature, that's something that Marianne was talking about earlier, going
yeah.
to the park there in D.C. and just being inspired outside, outdoors.
So, Marianne, you actually live in the D.C. area?
I live in the D.C. area. I live in a suburb of D.C.
Okay. I remember only going to D.C. one time, and I took a plane to someplace in Maryland and dropped down through Maryland. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? And into D.C.?
Yeah, this BWI is the airport,
Yeah, and I was so taken back by how beautiful on the right and the left as we were taking a bus down to whatever hotel we were staying at in D.C., how beautiful Maryland was.
Yeah.
You know, and because I was with Carol at the time, it was a ValPak convention, a coupon deal where we were out there. I was taken back by several things. One of them was the amount of, poor homeless people in that park. Near the White House.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you know, and this
yeah,
is, I'm talking
all,
about
yeah,
eight, 10 years ago. I don't know if it's changed, you know.
You know, even though there are a lot, well, there's a lot of jobs in the area. The housing is incredibly expensive. So, you know, you have a lot of homeless people who are working full time.
Right. They just don't have anywhere to go. And a lot of them just seem to congregate down there. So ironic, since all those important places to visit, all the historic places and the government buildings and all these things are so close. You know, and then the subway system was wonderful.
It must have been a while since you were down there. You know, it's gotten better though. The subway system really is improving.
Yeah, and then we went to someplace just north of Ways, and I think it was some city or community. Is there an Alexandria, maybe?
Oh yes. Oh, that's a lovely place.
Yeah, and you know they have a lot of historic poets and. History, people of merit and their homes where they lived and all that. That was really interesting.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah, Frederick is nice too. You know, once in a while we go up to Frederick to see a friend.
Yeah.
That's a nice place.
Yeah. But that's about all the babble I got for the night, so I don't know. Maybe I should just check on that. You guys continue.
All right. Well, thanks so much for calling in, Michael.
Thanks for calling.
You're welcome back on the show.
Well, you know, when I saw Marianne was here, you know, the immediate response was, okay, I got to listen to Marianne for a while. I got to do that. Okay, you know, nothing fancy here, nothing formal, just immediate impulse. I know her. I got to go there. Yeah, song is, got to get over there. Anyway, both of you would take care, and I just wanted to just wish you the best.
Thank you. You too.
Okay.
Take care.
Talk
to you later. Okay.
All right. Bye-bye. Take care, Mike. All right. Thanks to Michael Lee Johnson for calling in. Mm-hmm. And everyone should go check out his Facebook group called Contemporary Poets. And we got one more caller on the line here at an 818 area code. Caller from 818. Are you there?
Oh, yeah. Hello, Marianne. How are you doing?
Good. How are you doing?
This is Bill. I got a chance to hear you, so I thought I'd call in and say good job. I liked
thank you.
as much as I enjoyed reading, if my mother is in purgatory, I loved hearing it better.
Yeah, that's a fun one to perform.
Yeah, that's been one of my favorites from both the book and the anthology. But anyhow, I say I'm running back and forth here, but just wanted to sneak in, say hello, and good job. And
Thanks.
So I will let you to it. I'm
all right. Well, thanks so much for calling in and listening this evening, Bill.
Okay, bye-bye.
Take care. All right, so we've got about 4 minutes here left in the show, Marianne. If you want to maybe take us out with one or two more poems.
Sure. I think maybe, I'll try Facing Worcester. You know, again, this is another 5/4 poem, and this is a new poem that I hope will be in the new book.
Okay.
Facing Worcester, myself a compass needle, I face north towards my birthplace, the antique hospital on one of seven hills in the city of baths, piazzas, parlors, and tonic, words no one uses anymore. I face rice squares, African cloth stores, bodegas, and Indian fonts on bags of rice and red lentils, remembering the Polish nuns who fought Grampy on how to say his name. I face the city of Water Street, barrel of dill half sours, kosher soap, hipsters, whiskey bars. Okay. Actually, do I have time for one more? I should read something about my mother's side of the family.
Okay. Yeah, I think we should have time. We've got about 3 minutes left, so it should be time.
Okay,
for
this
one
is
more.
A short one. This is Woolworth, 1970. She remembers the lunch counter in her grandmother's city, half a day's drive on back roads to smaller towns in Canada. She didn't remember anyone black at the counter or in the stores. She remembers ordering a hamburger like grandma did, never looking at the cracked, greasy menu. She remembers cages of green parakeets, the thick smell of popcorn, heaps of butts and ash in the ashtrays on the counter. The long and winding road billowed out from the record shop, speakers like curtains in the summer. She wonders how different this Woolworth's was from the one in Greensboro in 1960. She thinks to ask her grandmother, but knows she never will. Okay.
All right. Nice piece to end on. And just want to say thank you so much for coming on tonight and sharing your story and reading some poems for us. And want to wish you well with the upcoming semester there and with your upcoming
books
as well.
Thanks. And good luck with your work and your show. And thank you for inviting me on.
Absolutely. It's been great talking with you, and
great.
Hope you enjoy the rest of your evening and the rest of your time off before things kick into high gear up there.
Oh, yeah. Thanks so much.
All right. Well, take care, Marianne.
Yeah. Good night.
Good night. And thank you to everyone for tuning in this evening and listening. If you'd like to appear as a future guest on any episode, you can get in touch with me at 17numa@gmail.com. And please do go check out Marianne Szlyk's website. The song is .com, and take a look at some of the past work there, and also send her some of your own poems as well, and keep a lookout for a future contest at that site as well. So take care, everyone. Thanks for listening tonight. We'll be back later this month. Selah.